Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Johnson. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 21st of July. India reports 3,998 new COVID-19 deaths, highest in a month. Taliban sought prisoner release, UN blacklisted names removed, says Afghan leader Atta Mohammed Noor. Muslims across India, Pakistan mark Eid al-Adha with prayers and sacrifice amid pandemic. And now for all the details. India on Wednesday logged 3,998 new COVID-19 deaths, the highest daily death toll in a month. This came after Western Maharashtra state reconciled its death count with over 3,500 previously unreported fatalities, the health ministry said. Meanwhile, the tally of infections in the country now stands at 31.22 million. India on Wednesday reported 3,998 new COVID-19 deaths, the highest death toll recorded since June 12, after the western state of Maharashtra reconciled its death count with 3,509 previously unreported fatalities, the health ministry said. The ministry did not give a reason, but authorities have in the past attributed other instances of deaths going unreported to administrative errors. The South Asian nation's tally of infections now stands at 31.22 million, with a death toll of 418,480, according to the official data. Meanwhile, opposition parties have slammed the central government over its remarks in the parliament on Tuesday that no death due to lack of oxygen were specifically reported. The government, however, said there was unprecedented surge in demand of medical oxygen during the second wave of COVID-19.
अभी थोड़े दिनों बाद ये भी कह देंगे कि कोरोना तो आया ही नहीं, पेंडेमिक तो था ही नहीं। अगर ऑक्सीजन की कमी नहीं थी, ऑक्सीजन से डेथ नहीं हुई, तो बार-बार, हर रोज, दिल्ली के अंदर ही हाईकोर्ट में एक के बाद एक हॉस्पिटल जा रहे थे, रोज कह रहे थे कि भाई लोग ऑक्सीजन की कमी है, ऑक्सीजन की कमी के से लोग डेथ हो रही है।
India's daily cases have fallen to 4-month lows after the second wave that crippled the healthcare system. But experts have warned the authorities against swiftly reopening cities and voiced concerns over crowding at tourist sites. In news from Pakistan, hospitals in Pakistan's largest city, Karachi, have been forced to refuse admission to new patients after reaching capacity amid an alarming surge in cases of coronavirus Delta variant, reports suggest. Health authorities have warned that the Eid holiday and upcoming elections in Pakistan-administered Kashmir could prove to be super-spreader events.
The spread of the coronavirus Delta variant is reaching alarming levels in Pakistan's largest city, Karachi, overwhelming public and some private sector hospitals, which are reaching capacity and have started refusing patients, medical officials said on Tuesday. Sindh provincial government spokesperson Murtaza Wahab said that the COVID-19 situation in Karachi is becoming serious and warned people that ignoring precautionary measures during the Eid holiday could make matters worse. In the last 24 hours, Karachi reported a positivity rate of 25.7% as compared with the national positivity rate of 5.25%. Pakistan, as of Wednesday, reported 996,451 confirmed cases of coronavirus, with 22,888 deaths so far. Health authorities have warned the Muslim holiday and upcoming elections in Pakistan-administered Kashmir on July 25 could prove to be super-spreader events, as government and opposition are busy holding big public gatherings.
Despite a high-level meeting in Doha between the representatives of the Afghan government and the Taliban, no ceasefire announcement was made for the festival of Eid al-Adha that began on Tuesday. Afghan politician Atta Mohammad Noor, who attended the two-day negotiations with the Taliban delegation, said the insurgent group has demanded release of more prisoners and removal of names of its leader from UN blacklist as trust-building measure.
Afghan politician Atta Mohammad Noor on Tuesday said the Taliban insurgent group sought the release of more prisoners and the removal of its leaders' names from the UN blacklist as a trust-building measure. Noor, who attended the two-day negotiations with the Taliban delegation in Doha, was of the opinion that this will not happen and the government will not repeat its previous act of releasing 5,000 inmates, which did not help in reducing violence or furthering the peace process in the country. Unlike some previous years, the Taliban have not officially declared a ceasefire for the festival of Eid-ul-Adha this week. On Monday, President Ghani accused the Taliban of having secret deals with Pakistan during a trip to review security situation in Herat province. On Tuesday, at least three rockets hit areas close to the Afghan presidential palace in Kabul. Visuals of the incident showed President Ghani and many others offering prayers of Eid-ul-Adha, even as a blast could be heard in the background. In a speech soon after the prayers, Ghani said recent deeds by the Taliban showed the group has no will for peace, and going forward, decisions by the government will be made based on that. The attack came amid clashes between the Taliban and the Afghan forces, which have escalated in recent weeks since the United States-led foreign troops completed their withdrawal from the country. Last week, Pulitzer Prize-winning Indian photojournalist Danish Siddiqui was killed while covering the clashes.
Moving on, fish farmers in Gilgit-Baltistan have blamed Pakistan government's ignorant attitude towards illegally occupied region for the falling economy, which has also affected the aquaculture sector. They have demanded relief from the government to overcome the losses they are facing amid the COVID-19 pandemic.
Fish farmers in Gilgit-Baltistan have blamed Pakistan government's sheer apathy and unclear policies for the downfall of the aquaculture sector amid the COVID-19 pandemic. Gilgit-Baltistan is one of the most picturesque regions and popular for trout breeding and fishing. A lot of local residents have taken up to opening fishery farms for survival. They have demanded for relief and assistance from the authorities to overcome losses they are facing amid the pandemic, but blamed government was not ready to take any interest. Gilgit-Baltistan, originally a part of India's Jammu and Kashmir, was illegally annexed by Pakistan 7 decades ago. Locals blame Islamabad's indifferent attitude towards the region has affected all sections of the society.
In news from Nepal, as Nepal's new Prime Minister Sher Bahadur Deuba begins consultations to expand his 5-member cabinet, discussions among several parties that supported him during the confidence vote in parliament has intensified. Deuba and Communist Party of Nepal Maoist Center Chair Pushpa Kamal Dahal met on Tuesday and discussed the common minimum program for the coalition government. Veteran leader Sher Bahadur Deuba was appointed as Prime Minister of Nepal last week after the Supreme Court reinstated the parliament that was dissolved in May. As Deuba begins consultations to expand his 5-member cabinet, discussions among the ruling parties has intensified. On Tuesday, Communist Party of Nepal Maoist Center Chair Pushpa Kamal Dahal met Deuba and discussed the common minimum program for the coalition government. The two leaders agreed to formulate a common program on behalf of the 5-party alliance. The Himalayan Times quoted Dahal's personal aide Bishnu Sapkota as saying, "When Deuba expands his cabinet, he will induct more ministers from his party Nepali Congress and the CPN Maoist Center. Coalition partner JSPN Janata Samajwadi Party Nepal will also join the government. In the meeting, it was agreed to scrap all political appointments made by former Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli's government by passing the parliamentary oversight. Besides the Nepali Congress, lawmakers from Dahal's party, the two factions of the Janata Samajwadi Party and a section of main opposition CPN-UML and Rashtriya Janmorcha supported Yuva. A community radio station in one of India's most backward districts is working to debunk coronavirus misinformation and ease concerns about vaccination over its airwaves. The radio station has brought in experts, doctors and COVID-19 survivors to help people better understand the dangers of the virus.
A community radio show is helping debunk myths and misinformation related to coronavirus and alleviates vaccine concerns among people in Nuh, one of India's most backward districts in northern Haryana state. Radio Mevat, through its programs and narrowcasting, relays health department messages regarding the deadly disease and vaccines in a simplified manner to the people of Nuh, which has a literacy rate of just over 55% below the state average. Sorab Khan, the radio station master, said they have been spreading awareness on a number of issues and countering fake news regarding the virus. He claimed around 300,000 people hear the programs daily.
लेकिन उसमें हमने जो experts हैं, doctors हैं, उनको अपने radio तक लेकर आए और लोगों तक information हम बार-बार पहुंचाए थे कि आप कैसे बचाव करेंगे, क्या ये बीमारी है, क्या इसके लक्षण हैं और उसके बाद जब vaccine आ गई तो लोगों को बहुत सारी वैक्सीन को लेकर भी लोगों के मन में भय था कि अगर हम वैक्सीन लगवाएंगे तो बांझ हो जाएंगे, बच्चे नहीं होंगे आगे चल के, वैक्सीन लगवाए तो धीरे धीरे आप मर जाएंगे, जो इस तरीके की बातें निकल गाती थी जो सोशल मीडिया पर आम रही हर तरीके की अफवाहें, तो रेडियो मेवात ने हर सवाल को नोट किया।
तो हमें इसका कुछ पता नहीं था, खाली डर था कि हम कहाँ जाएँ, कैसे बचें, क्या कुछ बच्चों को खुलाएँ। तो हमने फिर रेडियो के माध्यम से सुना था कि भाई रेडियो कोरोना से डरना नहीं है, इससे हमें सुरक्षित रहना है।
The health system in several regions in India collapsed in April and May as the country reported the world's biggest jump in coronavirus infections, increasing pressure on the immunization program. There is another community radio named Alfaz-e-Mewat, which has also been working to remove the misconceptions among people about coronavirus.
Amid COVID-induced restrictions on large gatherings, Muslims in India on Wednesday celebrated the festival of sacrifice Eid al-Adha by offering prayers at mosque. This is the second successive year that the festival is being celebrated with COVID-related restrictions. In neighboring Pakistan, millions of Muslims also performed Eid prayers amid concerns over the spread of coronavirus in the country.
Muslims across India on Wednesday celebrated Eid al-Adha, the festival of sacrifice, by offering prayers at mosques amid stringent COVID-19 protocols. To avoid crowding amid coronavirus, New Delhi's grand mosque, the iconic Jama Masjid, restricted the entry of devotees to the mosque, and only people living in the mosque complex were allowed to offer namaz or prayers on the occasion. In Srinagar city, the summer capital of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory, the scene was similar, with mass Eid prayers being suspended and only few devotees coming to mosques amid the pandemic.
Jami Masjid, jo puri tarah bhari rehti thi, bahar bhi hazaron log hua karte the. Humne bhi yahi tay kiya ki hame bhi iske ehtiyat rakhni hai aur ek misal pesh karni hai aur dusron ko message bhi dena hai. कि जामे मस्जिद को आम नमाजियों के लिए बंद रखकर सिर्फ वही लोग नमाज अदा करें जो जामे मस्जिद में रहते हैं, जामे मस्जिद कॉम्प्लेक्स में. तो आज भी यहाँ तकरीबन 15-20 लोगों ने ही ईद उल अदा की नमाज अदा की.
इंडिया सदर्न हैदराबाद, नॉर्दर्न जम्मू एंड अमृतसर सिटीज सॉ डेविटीज टर्न अप इन गुड नंबर्स टू ऑफर प्रेयर्स एट मॉस्क्स, वेयर ओनली सम वर फॉलोइंग कोरोना वायरस प्रोटोकॉल्स ऑफ वेयरिंग मास्क एंड प्रैक्टिसिंग सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग. Meanwhile, millions of Pakistani Muslims also performed Eid al-Adha prayers on Wednesday amid concerns over the spread of coronavirus in the country. In Pakistan's largest city, Karachi, where the spread of the coronavirus Delta variant is reaching alarming levels on the occasion of the Muslim holiday, congregations at mosques and prayer grounds were reminded to follow health protocols. Eid al-Adha commemorates the Quranic tale of Prophet Abraham's willingness to sacrifice his son as an act of obedience to Allah before Allah replaced the sun with a ram to be sacrificed instead.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline and follow us on Twitter @asianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.